So once we've collected some data, our next step is going to be analyzing the results. And an analysis is simply comparing your objective data to your original hypothesis. Does the data support your hypothesis or does it refute your hypothesis? And you're going to use statistics to help you here, so you're not just making a conclusion based on your feelings or general ideas, but statistics help us be objective about our analysis. There's two possible outcomes when you analyze your data compared to your hypothesis. You could match your hypothesis, and that doesn't mean you're done with the scientific method. It just means that you need to retest under new conditions. So you found out an answer that seems to be right for one particular situation, and now you need to try it under new ones. So maybe with the colds example we've been using, you found out something that works for college students, but maybe it's not the same for little kids or for elderly folks. So you would need to retest your hypothesis under new conditions and see if it still holds up. The other possibility is that the data does not match your hypothesis, and this does not mean you are a failure as a scientist and you need to stop and go do something else completely. This just means you go back to step two instead of step three. So now you're just going to go back and revise your hypothesis. And remember that we defined a hypothesis as an educated guess based on previous experience or knowledge. And after you do an experiment and you collect data, you have more information, and so you can refine and make a better hypothesis. So either one of these is part of the scientific method. So if we look at how that works, we've got our data coming in. We're analyzing our results. If it matches, you're going to go back and run additional tests. If it doesn't match, you're going to go back here, revise your hypothesis, and go through these steps again. Step six is one that people often forget about, and this is the peer review and publish step. This is when you share your results, and it's important that you share the methods and study design, the data that you actually collected, and your conclusions, statistics, and how you reached those conclusions. This does a couple things. It makes science self-correcting. If there is information that was not right, maybe you didn't analyze your data correctly, or maybe there was a basic flaw in your study design, the only way you're going to find out about that is if other people look at your information and start asking questions. And there's many discoveries that have happened over the last couple thousand years where we figured out, oh wait, the planet isn't flat. Oh wait, the Earth is not the center of the universe. And that comes from this public discussion of data. As we gain more information and knowledge, we share it, and that's a key part of science. It also, in a more practical sense, keeps us from repeating work unnecessarily. Think about the number of people who are working on breast cancer or AIDS research. If you figure out a drug that seems to work, you want to let everyone know about that. And equally important, you need to let people know if something didn't work. So it's a little hit to the ego to say that your hypothesis was wrong, but it's also an important part of science to share that information so that we can move on from that hypothesis and spend limited time and money on hypotheses that are more promising. Something that some people express frustration with scientists sometimes because they see a news story where you have two scientists sitting next to each other and they're arguing about something, and it's like, why don't they agree? They must not know what they're talking about. And scientists don't always agree. They're going to have a public discussion about how to interpret a particular piece of data. This disagreement does not mean they don't know what they're doing, though. This is instead just an uncomfortable but necessary part of the scientific method. So I have sort of a funny example of this. I went to the North American Bat Research Conference several years ago, and I was in a room with 200 of my people who all study bats having interesting conversations. And at one point, we were discussing the Western Mastiff bat and how they were really difficult to catch in nets. And there was sort of some grumbling from one side of the room, and some of the biologists that were working in the desert were like, "What do you mean you're not catching mastiff bats? We catch mastiff bats all the time, and here's this little cute mastiff bat face." And the biologists here in Northern California were saying, "Well, no, you don't catch mastiff bats. They fly too high, they don't come down until very late at night." And it turned into some name calling and maybe some accusations of, "Wow, you don't even know how to catch bats, and where did you go to school anyway?" And it was pretty uncomfortable for about an hour and a half. And discussion went on and on, and let me scroll down here to show you a map of where these guys occur. And so notice that there's the mastiff bats that are in the Sierras and the coast, and then there's mastiff bats down in the desert. And after a long conversation, what we figured out is the mastiff bats in the desert are behaving in a very different way than the mastiff bats in the mountains. And the techniques that you need to survey up here are different than the techniques you need to survey here. And so we actually moved forward for recommendations in our state about how we study the mastiff bat based on this really uncomfortable argument that actually led us to move our understanding of bats forward.